I don't think humans will ever again throw up their hands in the air and wave them like they just don't care. If the roof is on fire, I don't think we'll ever just let that motherfucker burn. I hear the consciousness of the world rising. I feel the walls breaking. I feel the tides pulling. When you hear water, water everywhere, not enough to drink, statistics never factor in the tears swallowed, the teeth sucked, the question marks dotted with bullet holes, the lines crossed, the fears realized. Suddenly, why the chicken crossed the road makes vivid sense. The chicken didn't know on the other side. Those who spread hate keep crossing gods. On hold, their truth like golden tickets into heaven, condemning others like a traffic cop don't even know if they're getting in themselves. Some on earth are already in hell. It's hard enough to walk in heels and curves and your own skin these days. How hard is it to comprehend that there is only one finish line for the human race? Why do we keep trying to cut each other off? I stopped and frisked myself once. I found a pen in my left pocket. You didn't consider it suspicious, but I saw it as a weapon of mass reconstruction. Change must come. I call it Field of Fireflies because I was in Bed-Stuy one night by this abandoned lot, and there was just this bunch of fireflies. And everybody was just walking by, and I was like, do you see this? These fireflies are amazing. Like, I don't know, I was amazed by it, and nobody else paid attention, so I was just trying to pay attention to all the little things in the world. This is House of Mirrors. I was in Asia, shopping. I tried to look for a small or extra small t-shirt to fit my frame, but these shirts fit babies. So I squeezed into a large. No wonder sumo wrestlers don't wear shirts. They have to leave the country or know a skilled seamstress with no time on her hands to sew one. What a way to wear curb calories for a continent. Came back to America and fit into a small again. I guess normal depends on who you're standing next to and in what country. I dated an African guy once. They say everyone strolls into your life for a reason. Perhaps it was only to sculpt these lines, because he told me. If I were to take you back to my country, they'd say you were sick for being too skinny. In his eyes, I was beautiful, but knowing that one day I would be unloved by his family, we had no future. Look, I can't control the fact that my metabolism is high and that I like the feeling of endorphins pumping up and down inside me, providing a free jolt of happiness when I exercise and my many attempts to get my blood sugars just right. So my diabetes doesn't control my life. Did you know that it is possible to be too skinny, very frail, and too weak to twist a bottle cap off? I was that little girl doctors prescribed to drink Pediasure to ensure that I wouldn't literally fly away on a windy day. So don't hate me. I won't hate you for all your curves and whatever you're doing to frame them. Can't we stand next to one another and redefine the new normal together? Can't we have a fashion magazine bonfire or confetti party because even the models don't look like the models? Makeup and Photoshop transform faces and body types with a few clicks and clacks. And though I know Uniqlo skinny jeans will fit me, their slogan that one fits all is false advertising. So I don't shop there anymore. I only believe in truth and anti-hypocrites, and we are all beautiful humans, and we should never allow animals who don't look in the mirror to see their own ugliness to tell us any different. Paper or plastic? I bet you'd never thought you'd see this face tell you she dreams in telenovelas. But I come from my father's blood and mother's milk. These mixed roots are no coincidence. Both worked the registers in a grocery store. My father browsed the aisles and left my mother's heart in the frozen food section. Her children have had to be her pints of ice cream she dug into. Sometimes she jabbed too hard with her ice picks without realizing the effects of brain freeze on her children. I got fed a lot of junk food from both parties. I had so much beef with my parents, I tried to be a vegetarian for a year. But my grandparents taught me what home was. Made sure I ate balanced meals so I would never be the bare bones of a conversation. Your mommy can't cook shit, so you better learn, said my grandfather. And if your daddy feed you bullshit, you can always eat here, said my grandmother. Their English may have been broken, but my grandparents put me back together on nights when my mother and father were their own crazy glue. My sister and I are the double-sided duct tape no one can ever pull apart. I would buy out the first aid aisle just for her. I have always taught her how to complete a do-it-yourself project, but I will always be her Home Depot if she needs me. If I should ever get to that aisle with the diapers myself, trust me, I'll choose loves over everything. Wow. Our country is suffocating. We all asthmatic, but we all matter. Walking out your front door is a safety hazard, but we all gather in solidarity because we all fractions, because the system's fractured and we just want a piece of America's apple pie, but it seems we are just bobbing for poisonous apples. Maybe we gotta go backwards to go forwards and barter our systems of goods so the government delivers. How come there's an app for everything except electing our officials? How come there's an app for everything except electing our officials? Why do we always have to vote between the lesser of two evils to find a greater good? I don't feel protected. Do you know your next door neighbor in your hood? Maybe it's about time that you did. When cops kill first and ask questions later, we become the walking dead. How many more bullet points of names must be listed before we stop filling up the graveyards with senseless killing? How do we educate our children when history repeats itself and corporate greed piles on the billions? Maybe the Messiah is still coming. Now would be great timing if he is. Maybe he came down, looked at the world, and shook his head and left. Let us be the love we want to see and stop all injustices. Because if we don't do it now, they could be coming for your head next.
Yeah.
Dear Brooklyn, I want a divorce. I do not recognize you anymore. We used to sip quarter waters at the corner store. Now there are no more corners. Just stories upon stories scraping the sky. Everything is on the rise and the natives are just scraping by. Hipsters be the new colonists. Landlords be the new freedom dealers. Borough of churches and dreamers. It's been a good 27 years together. Maybe we could stay pen pals and read each other. Brooklyn, you can keep the change. I'll take all my childhood memories. I hope that you'll remember me. You know that I will visit often. But somewhere along the subway lines, we lost it. And it's all setting in. I'll always love you. Brand new adventure. Let's begin.
Wow.
So this last piece was inspired by Philip Giambri, who gave me this writing prompt to like stuff my entire love life into 2 minutes. So it's called What the Hell's Love. At one. Out of all the futures I could have picked out of the birthday tray, I snatched the pen. I was destined to love writing at eight. I hate prompts from teachers, can't fit into their boxes. I'm too much start from my own scratching, not enough color inside the lines. I have word problems. At 10, I love Seth. I tell him to his face with the biggest Kool-Aid smile on mine. He tells me, you'll get over it. At 11, I love my English teacher. He gives me a reason to write on anything and any surface and makes us draw our poetic licenses to do so. I draw a stick figure identification card and learn. I hate drawing. He gives me a microphone in front of a packed house at the Walt Whitman birthplace. At 16, I love Greg, but he loves her, but she's 12 and he's 21. It's so backwards, so I take back all my words and all my I love yous and all my things. He still has my virginity, though. At 17, I love Xavier, but so do all the other girls who will do things for him that I will not. At 18, I love any man with a creative hand. Their ability to shape the air around them amazes me, but I learned that this is admiration, not love. I love everything that I want David to be, but nothing that he is. The feeling is mutual when he realizes I will never be Jewish for him. At 19, I love Andy, but he loves anything Asian and with alcohol. At 20. Yellow fever is real. At 20, I love a man with two names. who never went to college, whose hands are calloused from never breathing between jobs. He says the most honest conversations are naked, and they are. At 20 and a half, I love someone who finally admits they like me, and we are a beautiful disaster for 4 years. I miss naked conversations with the man with two names. My early 20s are a blur of misdirected Cupid arrows. It's not okay, Cupid. Noneofusmatch.com. At 26, I say to myself, you know, self, you kinda sorta maybe always like girls, you just never said it out loud before. At 26 and a half, I say it out loud, but she doesn't love me back. Lust becomes lifestyle, numb becomes natural. When I finally get fucked into fragile, I muster up the courage to say stop, drop, and roll, and out of bed. I don't know what the hell love is, but I know with every fiber of my being that this is not what it looks like. At 27, I build my wall so high around me, it is a struggle to hug anyone, even the ones I call family, because I'm so unsure of the ability of my arms to hold on to anything for longer than a blink anymore. I have a dozen significant others, all of them are my sisters and brothers, but I'm single and like Kraft cheese, I'm so vulnerable outside of my package. I invest in heavy-duty bullshit detectors, deny dates, and I'm not as easily impressed anymore. I have suffered too many casualties from casual sleep, and I'm just trying to celebrate now that the war with my body and my heart is over. I meet a battle-scarred warrior turned mosaic, and when she speaks, I think I finally have an inkling of what love is. And she is what it looks like.
Wow.